I am the living bread that came down from heaven, says the Lord. Whoever eats this bread will live forever.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the crowds, "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draw him, and I will raise him on the last day. It is written in the prophets, they shall all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to my Father and learns from him comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father, except the one who is from God, he has seen the Father. Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the desert, but they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We are in Easter season still, 50 days of celebration of the resurrection of Christ, which will end on the feast of the Pentecost, or the descent of the Holy Spirit. And then we go back to the ordinary time. And our theme for this year as a parish is to feel with the church, to think with the church. And therefore our goal is to inspire people, to encourage people, to deepen their sense of the parish, sense of the church. That is, that they would believe that to believe in Christ is also to believe in the teachings of the church. So it's no longer me and Christ, it's Christ through the church I will grow. Because spirituality, Catholic spirituality, is found in the church. So the world is there, a person is baptized, confirmed, then First Communion, sacraments of initiation, and within the church, the baptized is being formed to be like Christ, so that he will be, she will be ready to go up to heaven, to enter the kingdom of God, because the baptized is the adopted son of God. And because he is an adopted son of God or daughter of God, he has the privilege to inherit the wealth of the only begotten son, that is eternal life. But in order to make us adopted children of God, the only begotten son of God must die for us. Because what will make us adopted children of God is the breath that we will receive from the breath of the only begotten Son of God. He will die so that we will live. That's the theology. Unless the grain of wheat falls and dies, etc. He will die so that he could share his inheritance to us, his life to us. And of course, it's done by the Holy Spirit in the sacraments. That's why when we go back to the description of the church, again within the context of Easter season, the third form of the body of Christ, mystical body of Christ, the church, and in the context of what we are celebrating this in this parish, our theme, to feel with the parish, to think with the parish. So we meditated on the characteristics of the people of God. Again, I do not tire in teaching on this, about this. It is the people of God. So the origin is God. It's a people of God, not established by man. One becomes a member of this people, not by physical birth, but by being born anew, that is baptism. Baptism is the sacrament of faith, faith in Christ. The people, because we are the members, we should have the head. The people has the head, for its head, Christ, the anointed, the Messiah. So our head is not a human being. It's not a president. It's not a person in charge. It's not the council. It's not the Politburo. It's not the Senate. The head of the church is Christ. And as head, we need to consult him. We need to follow his commands, because he is the head. And his commands are found in the Bible. So we have the Bible. The head is Jesus Christ. He is the invisible head at this time. Before he went up to heaven in ascension, he established his church. And he chose Peter to become the visible head. But this visible head does not replace Christ. He represents Christ, because he is just a vicar of Christ. Christ still remains the head of the church. Invisible, because he is already in heaven, but the visible head, which he blessed and given the authority to lead the church in the office of Peter, the Petrine office, and together with Petrine office, the episcopal office. So the head, the visible head of the church, is the Pope. The invisible head is Jesus Christ, of course, through his Holy Spirit for the universal church. The visible head of the church in the diocese is the archbishop. That's why the archbishop or the bishop is also the vicar of Christ. He represents Christ, but in a smaller area, which we call diocese. Well, the Pope represents Christ, his vicar, in the universal church. The parish priest is also the head, but participates in the faculty or in the power of the bishop. That's why we obey our bishop. His directives, his circular letter, so we obey him. In fact, we promise to obey him all the day, all the rest of our lives. And we renew this promise of obedience during the Triduum, the Holy Thursday, during the Chrism Mass. Very solemn promise. I do obey you, because I believe you are the vicar of Christ and you have the grace of your office. You may not be perfect. You may not be very excellent, but we believe that Christ will give you the grace, because he has chosen you. You may be influenced by an enemy, but we will pray for you, because you are a good-hearted person. We will pray for you so that you will not succumb to temptation and that you will not be overcome by our enemies. So we pray for our heads. That's why every time we celebrate the Mass, we mention the name of the Pope, Pope Francis, and we mention the name of our incumbent Bishop Jose Romeo Lazo. All the Masses within the diocese mention the name of the Pope and the Bishop, because they are the visible heads of the church. Point of unity in terms of doctrine, point of unity in terms of worship, and point of unity in terms of administration. So thus he has the power to appoint parish priest, to appoint parish priest. He has the power to remove the parish priest or to transfer the parish priest, because he is presumed to know the situation of the diocese more than other priests, because his perspective, his information from different priests, from different organizations, is more comprehensive compared to a particular priest. For example, I am only informed about La Paz and some neighboring parishes, but the bishop has the information about Leganés, about Sara, about the diocese. So he is in charge. That's why he knows where to put his priest. He may consult groups of priests or lay people, but ultimately he is the decision maker. The rest is only consultative. The bishop may consult them, but the decision is upon our archbishop. Such the way the church organizes its ministry, its structure. So we have the point of unity. So in case of conflicts between or among priests, the bishop will make a decision, because he is our father. He is the point of unity. Imagine all priests are bishops. So what will happen? Thank God, there's only one bishop in the diocese and many priests. That's why he is our guide. He is the supreme teacher in the diocese, in the universal church, the Pope. He is the high priest in the diocese, in the universal church, the Pope. The Pope may not illegitimately intervene in the decision of the bishop, because the purpose of the Pope is to unify the pastoral work of the church at the universal level and to support the bishop. Support means not immediate intervention. Intervention when the bishop is negligent. The Pope has the authority to intervene. But if he's doing good, it's not good that he will intervene immediately or make a decision for the priest of Haro immediately. That's why he entrusts the work to the bishop. Subsidiarity, we call it subsidiarity. The Pope only has two occasions to intervene in the diocese. If the bishop is negligent, that's why the higher authority has the duty to repair, to give remedy immediately, to arrest scandal, and to correct the situation. And then the second reason that the Pope can intervene is to send help if the diocese lacks of resources. So it's more of helping rather than directly replacing the bishop. He will replace the bishop either by himself or by his delegate when there's a problem. But when everything is okay, the Pope will always trust his bishop. That's how the church intervenes. Unlike the world, those who are in power, higher power, always intervene. In the lower power, everything, even the decision. But the church, no. No. That's why we always obey our bishop. That's the beauty of the church. That's how we think of the church. That's how we feel with the church. That's why the church exists and continue to exist, because its inner core is not humanity, but divinity. Its power does not come from man, comes from the Holy Spirit. The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So, the head is Christ, and we consult the head always, most especially about faith and morals. Then the status of the people is the dignity and freedom of the sons of God. So, hindi kita oppressed. Sa iban nga mga state, oppressed ang tao. Wala freedom. Pinakontrol. Gusto i-control. Kung wala pa mang ginakontrol, may plano nga i-control. That's not the status when you are a member of the church. You have the freedom. Your freedom will be respected. That's why kanami iyas ang church, kung tanawon mo gid, ang status naton, dignity naton is as member is the children of God, and you are safe in the church kun amo ini tanan. Tigulang, disabled, poor, ginakilala gid nga may dignity sa church, and equal treatment, so to say. Of course, may mga kung may mga differences, hindi na ginatudlo sa church, mga errors ina sa amon nga pari. Ti Father nga equal-equal, tinga doon ginapaburan niya man to. Iya na iya personal, pero the church herself, wala gatudlo sina, kagwala sinang sing sistema nga amo sina. Yung sistema sang church iya is respect sa dignity sang tao, and at the same time, freedom of the sons of God. Wala sang freedom in terms of faith and morals. Wala pagustuhanay kung ano imo faith. Kundi gina, may freedom ka sa mga bagay nga non-essentials, pero essential to your salvation, wala freedom. Why? Because it's for your good, for your salvation. Ang bata karon may freedom, pero ang ginpili iya, malain para sa iya. So there's no freedom, ginahambal lang church, no. Freedom iya is for your holiness, for your integrity. No. There's no freedom in sin. There's no freedom in licentiousness. That's why ang freedom sang church is always the freedom of the Holy Spirit. Freedom of being sons and daughters of God. Freedom from sin, ultimately. Dugangan ko subong nga adlaw, second to the last, pa sa aton nga characteristics of the people of God, nabutang diri, the law, its law is the new commandment to love as Christ loved us. This is the new law of the Holy Spirit. So kadamo sa mga laws, damo sa mga laws, traffic, economic, kung ano nga mga laws, diri sa aton kabuhi, kaya diri kita mong may relationship kita, basta may relasyon, may law. Kung wala relasyon, wala law. Kaya ang law iya nag-regulate sang relasyon. Hindi mo matagaan law ang particular person kung wala siya hindi sa relasyon. Intrahan mo iya conscience? No, it's not his, hindi kasulod ang law sa conscience because it's the private autonomy sang tao. Ang law nagagwa lang kung mag-relate na siya. Example, kung nagatulog man lang ko sa kwarto ko, himuan mo gid ako law. Pero kung nagatulog ako, kag naga-snore ako, nga makadisturb sa iban, nag-relate na ako. Dira, kasulod. Kung dinima lang ko sa balay ko, kag naga-hampang ako yasang tungits. Private autonomy. Pero kung maimbitaron ako nga iban, halinsagwa, kag magtungits, tilay na naya. Kaya nag-relate ka na sa iban. Dumdumon ginaton ina. Kaya kung kaisa nag-overreach ang law, ginaintrahan niya ang mga private autonomy. Dumdumon ginaton ina. Kaya basta panindugan nga ang law can only regulate something when there is an alteridad. Dumduman ko ginahambal sa amon professor sa Spain. Ang law iya hindi sa individualidad. Ang law is in the alteridad, meaning alter, other people when you relate. Kung gabinaho ka imuda, kag ikaw malang isa, pagusto ka. Pero kung gabinaho ka, kag nagadisturbo sa tanan, okay, hindi niya pwede. Kung magkaon ka sa pagkaon nga baho, kag imo malang dira, pagusto ka dira. Pero kung magsungaw ng pagkaon mo, kag hindi natuya ka nadisturbo ng iban, i-regulate. Nga, kaya nagwa na siya. That's why ang marriage, law, tik private man na, Father. Ginatugan ng law, kaya mabata pa mo. Pagbata niyo, budgetan na, eskwelahan na, may health na, may ano na. That's why nag-intra ang law. Ginahambal ko lang, ina, para nga, clear sa aton, nga may mga private autonomy, kag may conscience. That's why ang church hindi ka-intra sa imo conscience. Hambalya, vote according to your conscience. Why? Kaya may freedom. The law is the new commandment of love. Kagang highest law is love. Other things, commentaries on love, specifications of love. Pero ang highest law sa simbahan is the love of God and the love of neighbor. In other words, kapamangkot kita. Ining law ko sa baptism, parte sa balayran sa bunyag, ga-express inibala sang love of neighbor o kon injustice. Ining law sa paggamit sang simbahan, kag pagbayad sang kuryente, sa mga kasal, kag sa ano sina, nag-express bala sang justice kag love of neighbor o simple negosyo? Ining mga religious articles nga ginabaligya dira, justice inabili kag nag-develop sang love of God and love of neighbor o kung sobra-sobra nga ganansya? Ining structure sa simbahan, create gid man ini parang ang tao love God and worship God and love their neighbor o simply economic income generating project? Ang organisasyon nag-take care gid bala sa tao nila sa ila prayer meeting o ginagamit lang ila 10% na tithing? Dira naton makita. That's why ang law sa simbahan is the law of the commandments, the love of God and the love of neighbor. Meaning to say, makahimo ka sang projects, kag makalead ka sa tao, kag makapangayo ka sa ila, even maka-extract ka sa ila kung kinahanglanon gid, basta always for the worship of God and for the love of neighbor and love of God. Pero kung love of self, love of power, hindi legitimate ang paghimo mo sa ng project, kag pag-decide mo sila, kag paghimo mo sa mga rules, kay selfish ina, egotism ina, kag hindi inaya gospel based. Amo nang implications ang law of love. Of course, hindi mo na ma-impose sa secular society. Iti, mahambal siya, hindi mo kaya katulik ko ya, lain man ang amon. Iti okay. Pero sa church, kung diin ka man magkadto, it's always the love of God. That's why matouch ako, magsiling Father, wala kami bala bayad, pero mailubong kami. Teko ni Kaobe, ano unahon mo? Bayad o kunang kaluoy? Bala niyong sabat. Kakuna mo ng guide naton to feel with the church, to think with the church. Wala favoritism. Kay tungod ang law na nag-govern sa aton is to worship God and to facilitate everything sa kaya naton para ang tao makasimba kag makahigugma sa Dios. In case of conflicts, ang akon pamangkot, sino sa ila nga duha ang lapit sa love of God and love of neighbor? Kay sino suggestions? Best suggestion, meaning suggestion nga nag-implement sang law of love. Sino sa ilang nga duha ang maka-express sining law of love sa decisions about the fiesta, about Holy Week, about anything? Criteria ini, bisan sa akon, san sa inyo. Question, nag-grow bala ang tao sa love of God and love of neighbor. Nami mga suggestions sila, pero isa lang piliyon ko, sinong my best na makalead sa tao sa love of God, love of neighbor. Imagine ninyo kung di love of God ang nag-motivate sa akon, kundi economic. Love of money. Lain akong piliyon. Pero kung clear nga love of God, lain ang decision. That's how we feel with the church and think with the church. Amen. Father, by the love of your Spirit, may we who have experienced the grace of the Lord's resurrection rise to the newness of life in joy. Grant this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.